Lovely, 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 lovely.
Temporal Discussion, the episode-by-episode nightmare retrospective podcast. I'm Martin Harder, and I definitely thought it was real until they started using those low-res photos.
And I'm Martin O'Doney, and I thought it was real until I saw the good guys win.
And joining us once again, we have the editor of the online version of the Eye Shield and the man behind Nightmare the Lost series, Jake Collins.
I'd like to do something a little different and begin with a shout-out today. As I mentioned on episode 14, one of my many roles in life is that of lollipop person. And I'd like to give a shout-out to my colleague and fellow lollipop person, Gareth, who listened to this podcast, heard me on it, took the time to cross the road and come to my crossing site on the way to his one morning. Tell me that he heard me on this podcast and talked to me about Nightmare.
This is actually pretty major, this, Mr. H. We are the number one podcast among lollipop people. And I think we should add a badge. In fact, that should be the front cover for this episode. Number one podcast among lollipop people.
Yes, we represent the Lollipop Guild.
Yes.
It certainly tickled me. I was very pleased with that.
I'm really moved by this. This is a wonderful moment. I never thought I'd make it amongst the lollipop people until now.
Today we're looking at Series 4, Episode 16, the very last episode of this series, which was broadcast on Friday, December 21st, 1990. Ice Ice Baby was still the number one single, and Home Alone was still the number one movie.
The legal action over Ice Ice Baby hadn't happened yet. It was still in the future.
Not yet.
Temporal Discussion. Temporal Discussion. Bringing you the latest news from 1990.
The Alma Ata Protocol, which effectively founded the Commonwealth of Independent States and thus formalized the dissolution of the Soviet Union, was signed into law by representatives of 11 of the 12 surviving Soviet republics, the exception being Georgia. In addition, they acknowledged and welcomed the resignation of the Premier, Mikhail Gorbachev. Gorbachev told CBS News that he would step down as soon as he realized the CIS was becoming a reality, even though he had not yet formalized his plans to leave the government. And it's just one of the many things that caused chaos for the next 7 years, was the fact that he wasn't actually ready to go. I remember at the time everyone was so excited as the death of the USSR meant it was the end of the Cold War and we'd survived the nuclear annihilation threat and everything, and everyone was so happy. And I got caught up in that as much as anybody. And in a way, it's true, you know, the Cold War did effectively end in Europe there. The nuclear threat did kind of elapse, but Russia itself just became a relentless hellhole of crime, social chaos, and political turmoil for the next 10, 11 years. And the guy I blame for it is Boris Yeltsin, believe it or not. Everyone idolizes Boris Yeltsin because he stood on the tank during the putsch. And that makes him some kind of superhero. But he was actually an absolute knucklehead when it came to running a country. He had no idea what he was doing. He basically let the Americans tell him how to run the economy. And within 1 hour of the markets opening at the start of 1991, inflation quadrupled.
Wow.
In Russia. The price of a loaf of bread on the last day of 1990 was a quarter of what you had to pay for it in 1991, because one of the first controls they got rid of were the price controls. And of course, that meant everybody was suddenly going hungry all across the major cities around Western Russia. And Yeltsin didn't know what to do about it, so he immediately called in more American so-called economic experts. And they basically said, right, remove these controls as well. And they found Inflation went up even faster, and it led to unrest, enormous poverty. People were basically selling their household goods just to get something to eat that day. And they came up with this rationing system where everything that was that had been denationalized, everybody got shares in, and they could use their shares to gain wealth from it. They ended up having to sell their shares just so they had enough money to eat that day. And the tiny number of people who got the shares suddenly became massively rich and started running the country as a mafia operation. Those are the oligarchs of legend in Russia. And it was all because Yeltsin didn't know what he was doing. He basically, you know, you think about guys like Roman Abramovich, Yeltsin is the guy to blame for the emergence of people like Abramovich. And 1/6 of the Earth's surface effectively became Gotham City. There was no law. There was if you went to court, you could just quite cheerfully buy your way around the law if you were rich. And if you didn't have enough money, you were done for.
And now time turns. The recording light burns. Timeout is gone. The podcast is on.
Greetings, and welcome to the final phase of our dungeon game. Yes, of course it's a game. You didn't think it was real, did you? I'll let you into a little secret. There's a very real adventure going on down here. And if he could only concentrate and find the book, Pickle could tell us how it's progressing.
Yes, Master. A moment, Master, while I find the place on the quest for the cup that heals its Robin, Andrew, Brett, and Giles. Over 20 minutes down the path. Level 2, Master, but not carrying.
That can change. We must waste no time, for there's little to spare. Hurry, team. Game on.
Where am I?
You're in a room.
A kitchen.
A kitchen, it looks like. And there's a table to the left of you and a monk sitting at the table.
What should we do?
Pax vobiscum. Welcome, young friend. Welcome, mucus saltuverat. come, sit down, join me. And then maybe, maybe ale nobiscum. I'm comfortable. Yes.
Yeah.
Excellent. Put that shield down by your side.
Okay.
I think. Yes. That's better. Spectator illos homines. I think not. People around here don't like being spied on by magic shields, I must tell you.
Giles has emerged in the kitchen room. At a table, playing patience with a deck of large print cards, sits Brother Mace. After Giles sits opposite him, Mace introduces himself. He says he has been contemplating the follies of the wide world and also drinking a lot of ale.
I just want to warn everybody before we get any further that this is possibly my least favourite episode ever, so brace yourselves for a lot of whinging.
I'm here to provide a bit of contrast because it's another one of my favourites. Certainly one I've always enjoyed watching a lot.
And I have no overwhelming opinions in either direction, apart from a slight disappointment towards the end.
Mace goes on to explain that he happens to have a joker to hand.
Yeah, but he doesn't, does he?
This is what everyone remembers. He pulls a card out of the pack and shows it to Giles without looking at it.
Do you speak Latin?
No.
Oh, quel ignoramus maximus. In that case, you will not know the meaning of the Latin word iocus, will you?
No.
Say no, Jones.
It's fair.
Oh, dear. Lack of education amongst modern youth is really a disgrace. Well, iocus means joke or joker. And I happen to have a joker here. And I think you should take him with you upon your voyage.
It's the Three of Hearts. He hands the card to Giles, still without looking at it himself, and tells him to take the card with him on his voyage. Mace finally captures a glimpse of the card and begins frantically searching through the cards for the correct one.
Oh, no, it's not. It's not the joke. I've lost the joke. That's the Joker. Oh, dear. I'm sorry, I had a nasty moment there. There is the Joker, young friend.
Thank you.
Take him with you and play him what... Play him wisely.
Okay.
And of course you can play him only once. Now, take up your shield once more and go forth into the wide, wicked world.
Say bye, Giles.
Bye.
Can't throw
take care, young Giles. And if you find any ale, send it back to me.
And with that, the team guide Giles out. We spoke to Michael Kuehl, of course, who played Brother Mace, about this scene when he appeared as a guest on our previous episode. And this is what he had to say.
This is me improvising. The Dungeoneer comes into a room and seated there at a table, burbling at a mug of some sort of booze, is Brother Mace. He greets him in his normal florid style. I'm not sure I can do that voice anymore. But he says, sit down, my dear young fellow. Young voyager, young traveller, yeah. Young quester.
Roll your ass. You know what I mean.
Kindly take your seat and put it upon the chair provided. I ask him questions about, does he understand Latin? And I say how terrible it is that he doesn't. He won't know what the word Iocus means, because I'm playing cards at the table, and I'm supposed to be doing all this business with the cards. And he says, well, Iocus means joker, and here I hold up a card, and it's the Three of Hearts. It's the Joker. And he says, no, it's not. And there is, at this point in time, a moment of genuine actor's cold-blooded panic.
So that was going to be my next question.
All right. That is. I said last episode, or what's going to be broadcast as last episode, I said that you have a lot of lines and you have a lot of business, and you have to without rehearsal, go in and do it with the kid and make all that work. And sometimes this gets a little bit much. Now, I've been given instructions about how to do this bit with the cards. I'd rehearsed it, which was unusual. And then I tried to go through it, and it wasn't where I expected it to be. And as I said to Tim afterwards, there'd been a process of him allowing me to do more and more improvisation in my bits. And this bit, all the stuff about all the drunk acting and the stuff about the how terrible it is that the education of people now, young children nowadays, is me pushing stuff in. And that was going wonderfully. And I'd got cocky, I think is my diagnosis at this distance in time. And somehow I'd lost track of the card. Now, I'm very proud at that moment that I panicked in character.
Yes.
Yes.
I panicked as Brother Mace, not dropping the voice, not dropping consciousness of where he was, but doing it as he would. And it doesn't last very long, but I recover from the panic and I show him and give him the correct card.
Yeah. Panic is very, very visible, though. We're at that moment, we can all keep see you constantly glancing just over at the camera.
Yeah, I was going to mention that. Yeah. I was honestly going to mention that and not try to brush it over as a moment of supreme embarrassment to me. I would say I am both proud and slightly ashamed of this scene. I'm proud because the drunk acting worked both before the fumble and after, and it got laughs out of the kids, which is, you know, goal.
That's the aim.
Yeah. And it didn't happen very often because they were so nervous. But if you can get a laugh out of them, it makes the whole thing flow so much better. And I'm really quite proud of the fact I kept it in character. But even before, I was glancing over at the camera much more than I should have been. It's partly, I think, because you've got the Dungeoneer in front of you and he hasn't got a face. You've got nothing you can focus on in a natural sort of way as you would with another actor on the stage. And so I've also got, as I recall it, an earbud in, and I'm getting fed comment, sarcastic and otherwise, from the
this is what I was going to ask you.
From the control booth upstairs. And I think at least half of those glances at the camera are glares at the camera, saying, you just shut up now, please. And as I say, it was a wonderful moment because it worked in the end. And it was also just about 1.2 seconds of complete nightmare in the time between, that's not it. Where is it? Where is it? Where is it? And the fact that I reacted as Brother Mace would have done, and nothing didn't lose it. I think is a good thing, but on the other hand, I don't know what went wrong. It was an overcomplicated piece of business, I think, that got lost that I lost in the setup and in trying to look natural and trying to do the dialogue with the kid, and that's what went wrong.
You drop one of the balls without noticing.
That's right. And I found it again, and I covered. But it is, as you said, those glances at the camera are sheer cold sweat.
Shut up,
Tim.
Shut up.
I didn't say that.
No, you didn't.
I may have projected that.
Your face was definitely saying, shut up, Mr. Child. I know what's gone wrong. Let me sort it out. Was there that's the thing I was going to ask you, though. Was there a lot of bad language suddenly rushing into your ear?
I can't remember at this late date.
Was
there were definitely, oh my gods. And I apologized to him afterwards, but looking back on it, I think the whole business with having to actually do a practical, I think I was supposed to be playing patience and shuffling the deck and things. I think that was overly complicated.
Too many slots were full and active at the same time.
Much stuff to take track of. I was, as always, concentrating on the performance, on getting the lines right and the mood right and the laugh right.
The tragedy is that this is probably the best scene of the episode. It's a recycle from another quest again, of course, but also the entertainment value comes entirely from the fact that it's a mistake. Michael definitely saved it, though. You did well to stay in character all the way through, although the glancing at the camera was a bit obvious.
Right, Joss, turn to your right and go for the door. Keep going, doing all right. And go through the door.
Giles?
Yeah?
You're in a large room, and at the far end of the room, there looks to be like a door, but it's closed.
It looks like it's a pit in front of you.
Looks like it may be another door monster, perhaps, Master. Time for the calling, perhaps?
Yes, but do they remember the right words? So much to remember and such a short time to do it in.
I command you.
No, the Latin word.
Say Iocus.
Iocus!
Not the right words for this situation, I feel.
Just say true or false.
True or false?
False or true.
False or true.
False or true?
Open up and let me through.
Open up and let me through.
Ooh. Open up and let me through.
Oh, phew.
Write that down.
This one, I believe, is called Dorcas. Not quite as miserable as Doris, but not a master of hilarity either.
Oh, we're in a sad despair. Ah, the bitter pill of self-delusion.
Oh, shut it, for goodness sake. Oh, shut it. You get it?
You're very droll, Giggle.
Truth will open. Truth will out.
One of the advisors thinks of using the phrase, I command you.
Yeah.
Which kind of gave me some nostalgic feels.
Nostalgic, yeah, but it's not very sensible, is it? I mean, why would weeping doors respond to the word joke, for instance? Unless it's a really, really bad... it's a motley joke, isn't it? That's going to be why. You notice that Michael Kuehl is actually appearing in two scenes on the bounce here, because he's the one who provides the voice of Dorcas.
We were talking on episode 13 about challenge cutting bits either side of the adverts. In the full version of this episode, Brett also attempts to use I command you when they get three questions right with Oakley, and Challenge originally cut that to put the adverts in, which I guess makes more sense to try and use I command you there based on previous Nightmare gameplay. It does seem that this team, particularly Brett, is rather obsessed with Series 3. There's that. There's the insistence on saying the name of the spell, not just spellcasting D-A-S-H, but spellcasting dash D-A-S-H. I think they wanted it to be like Series 3, and it wasn't at all. And they certainly weren't alone in that way.
I definitely think their mind isn't always on what's right in front of them. There are definitely times when you think their head is somewhere else. Maybe their head is in season three.
You get the impression that they've kind of recorded a lot of series three and have watched it back.
This seems like a good place for me to say, I do find end of series episodes rather a mix. Bag, particularly when it's obvious they don't really have time to win. So watching it for the first time, it's like, well, is this going to keep me interested? Now, despite what people have claimed at times, Giles's team doesn't really have time to win by the standards of the other quests in the series. It really takes three whole episodes to win in series four, not two and a tiny bit. Yes, if Tim had wanted, he could have given Giles a truncated quest and win. Obviously, he didn't want to. But this is one of the end-of-series episodes I do enjoy more. Not because of the team, really. I don't really rate them. But some of the events in the episode were things I did want to see happen in the series and hadn't seen yet. And I did find it very stimulating when I first watched it. Other end-of-series episodes, like the end-of-series 5, were some of my least favourite ones. End-of-series 3 I like, not because of the event, but because I like the team. I find them very stimulating. Whereas end-of-series 4, I like some of the scenes that are chucked in before the end of the series that did manage to keep me interested when I was 7. So I'll be sure to point out which those are, the ones that Martineau hates.
Very probably. There is an issue, actually, at the end of the series, that right at the end of the episode, that I'm going to point out that is sometimes overlooked about it, which actually means they needlessly cut off a quest, which they could have just finished in a natural way at exactly the right moment to end the series. But we'll come to that when we get to it.
Mother of Pearl is a giant oyster. True or false?
The absolute certainty that Brett has when he says it's true, and the death look that Robin gives him afterwards.
That is absolutely hilarious, that little exchange.
True or false?
Giles, that one's true. Say true.
True.
Falsehood.
That one's true, say true. Of course it's not.
What does your research find, Mr. H?
Well, Nakle, which is another name for Mother of Pearl, is an organic-inorganic composite substance that's formed as the inner shell layer by certain mollusks. It's also a substance that makes up pearls. So I can kind of see where they were coming from.
But it is the pearl rather than what created the pearl, I think is the point that the riddle's making. And I think that is accurate.
It makes up the interior layer of freshwater pearl mussel shells and the outer layer of farmed pearls.
The Red Sea is saltier than the Dead Sea. True or false?
Very false. People have been known actually to lie down flat on their backs on the surface of the Dead Sea and just lie there reading newspapers or books because the salt density is so great that it actually props them up.
Am I right in thinking that neither of them are actually seas?
The Dead Sea is an inland saltwater lake, isn't it, really?
It's certainly not one of the seven seas, if you're going to use old-fashioned terminology like that. Whatever you want to call it, it is an amazing body of water. It's quite extraordinary how different it is from any other lake or sea.
Well, it has a salinity of 33.7%, which is almost 10 times saltier than ordinary seawater.
Yeah, they say that if you drink seawater, you'll soon go mad. So if you drink water from the Dead Sea, you'll immediately wither your tongue to a root, and you'll probably go mad before you finish swallowing the first drop of it.
If you evaporated a litre of Dead Sea water, you'd have around 250 grams of salt left behind.
8.5 times greater than the same quantity of Red Sea water.
I thought of saying for my intro, I'm Jake Collins, and I am saltier than the Dead Sea. But it's not really true. I'm not salty at all.
Nickel is the name of a legendary goblin who lived in a German copper mine. True or false?
The correct answer, of course, is really, we don't know. When you've got a story in fairy tales about goblins, it's actually usually about people who had stunted growth, something along those lines. They're often vilified by people who didn't understand the illness. It's possible that there was somebody with some form of growth disorder living down a German copper mine that the name comes from, but we don't really know.
I couldn't find any story about one particular goblin who lived in a copper mine, but what I did find find out was that a dark red ore with a distinctive green coating started to irritate copper miners in Saxony, Germany, as early as like the 1600s. They carried on mining it, thinking that it was copper ore. But because the ore was making them sick, the miners resorted to legend and came to believe that goblins were guarding it. So as a result, the ore was eventually given the name Kupfernickel, which translates to goblin's copper.
One thing we do know, which makes it plausible because of the similarity of the name, pumpernickel bread was basically invented in that part of Saxony and was the staple diets of copper miners in that region for centuries. And the name, again, it's nickel, but there was a horse called Nickel, apparently, according to this legend. And it was called pumpernickel because this form of bread was so sour and so difficult to actually chew. They said this bread is only good for a horse. So I don't know, maybe that's linked to the legend. I don't know, because it's a Kupfernickel and Pumpernickel do sound quite similar.
True.
Truth accepted.
Yeah. Oh, well done.
Oh dear.
Having given two correct answers, the team guide Giles onward.
This is quite a significant nightmare moment that always gives me a bit of a pang. It's a bit of gameplay going back to the first episode. Although it's not a clue room like it was there. But it's the last time you'll see a face projection or mouth projection, wall monster, door monster, creature, asking them three questions, for truth, accepted, or falsehood. And it always gives me a little bit of sadness inside.
Riddles become much less a central part of the gameplay from now on. It's one of the things which is making the game increasingly passive and less like an actual interactive work of on-screen fiction.
Right, the door's dropped down the drawbridge.
And walk forward. Giles, you're walking along a forest path.
Okay.
This foul-looking place is Dunkley Wood. Best remind us of its hazards, Pickle. After all, you've walked there.
Not for many years, Master. In any case, it looks to have changed. You can get back into level 2 from here, team. But only if you find the Dunswater and cross it. The elf path should be safe for most of the way, but since the elves left, Ariadne has built her lair across it. Now, let's just hope she's fed recently and is sleeping. Makes me shiver just to think of her.
Anyway, we arrive in Dunkley Wood, and then we leave it again, basically.
Ariadne's lair is still Dunkley Wood.
Well, yeah, but I mean, this particular bit of Dunkley Wood, this clearing, this picture, they arrive in it and they just walk straight out of it. It's just more camcorder footage. Get rid of it.
When I first watched this episode and Pickle was doing his "you're nearing Ariadne's lair" spiel, I thought, oh, yes, they're getting through level 2 more quickly than usual. It's shorter. Good, we're going to get to see Merlin and the bargain redeemed. So I guess they're speeding things up a bit to fit in some interesting stuff, but I doubt he'll do 2 whole levels.
You've entered a clearing, Giles. Just to the left of you, there's a portal or an entrance to a tree.
Tree trunk, yeah. Should we start to head there? Right, if you could turn to your left, Giles.
Extreme caution, team. You are nearing Ariadne's lair. The strands of her web are extremely sticky. One touch and Giles could be trapped forever.
There's the web.
They do now reach the entrance to Ariadne's lair, which is once again a very, very small hole in the side of a tree that somehow a gigantic tarantula can easily fit through. I'm actually going to speak up in defense of the team here, because it's one of those things, it's easy to get the impression that they're not handling it very well because it takes so long for the portal to trigger. But I actually think that's just the production crew being overly precise here. Especially the team bicker briefly over whether it's sidestep or just turn and walk. Just as Ariadne's appearing, Giles is heading into the portal. He's heading towards it, but he's just a tiny bit right of center on it. And for some reason, maybe Tim is in a bad mood. No, you've got to be more precise than that. So they have to do another shuffle a little bit further. Oh dear, the spider's getting near. And it gives the impression that that Brett's guidance isn't very good. Actually, in the cold light of day, he's unlucky that the portal isn't triggering quicker.
Bit left, and walk forwards. Quickly, walk forwards. Sidestep to your left. And walk forwards, quickly. Sidestep to your left. Turn to your left. Run forwards.
You're in a room. And above you, there's like a huge spider web. And in front of you, there's a piece of wood with some stuff on it.
Joss, could you go towards the trunk, please? And there's some objects. What are they?
There's an orange.
Right. Put it in your knapsack. And what's the other thing?
Oh, Master made them. Hurry, I can sense her. She's coming!
It's a bar of gold.
Pick up the bar of gold on the card. Turn to your right. Is that the exit? Walk forwards. Quickly, run forwards!
Queen of the Arachnids, use what you may, but use the silence!
I bloody hate this scene! This is... it makes the Adore spell scene look mature and thought-provoking, this scene. I hate it. We're going to play the Joker that Brother Mace doled out earlier.
I would rather take my chances with the giant spider.
So would I.
Jumps into action, flexes his mighty muscles. Core, what a body, I says to myself, and prepares for deadly combat. Greetings, young helmet head.
Hello.
Thanks for dealing me into the game. You won't be disappointed, I promise you. Now, where's the opposition, eh?
Behind him. John, say it's behind him.
Behind you.
Well, madam, I've got to say this. You are so ugly that you makes gross look good. Just look at you.
He's demented, Master. He's out of his pack.
Oh, I'm not so sure. Remember, ridicule is a powerful weapon in the hands of a professional.
Hey up, Bladderbots. Wait for this. Do us a favour. Look in a mirror and murder yourself.
I don't think she can take anymore. No, look, she's had enough. She's off.
Say well done, guys.
Bye-bye, Spidey!
Wow, this is comedy, man. You're so ugly that you makes gross look good. Ridicule is a powerful weapon in the hands of a professional. What's that got to do with Motley? Look in a mirror and murder yourself. These aren't even bloody jokes. They're just crude abuse. This is football hooligan standard stuff. This isn't jokes.
I helped to admin a large Facebook group for neurodivergent people. And that's the kind of thing that would get us zooked. If someone commented that, then Facebook will come and shut us down.
Yeah. The algorithms on modern social media won't tolerate a line like that. I'm not actually advocating censorship of it, but it is rubbish. I've also got to criticize the team a little bit. They don't think this is funny any more than anybody else's. They're laughing because they're expected to by the scripts. You know, maybe there's a bit of nervous tension in the laughter as well, but they don't find the lines any more amusing than the audience do. They're crap. This is awful dialogue. I want Ariadne to eat Motley. That's what I want. And instead she runs off because he said a couple of nasty lines to her. Thankfully, this is not Ariadne's final appearance. She returns in season 6 and in the Geek Week episode.
And series 5 too.
Is she in series 5 as well? Okay, cool. It's just as well as it gives her a chance to repair her aura of menace, because this is yet another of those awful scenes where the dignity and the threats of one of the big characters or monsters is totally ruined.
Just for clear cross-referencing, the episode where Ariadne appears in Series 5 is the same one where Oakley appears. So there's something to look out for in the near future.
There you go, Helmet Features.
Thanks.
You played your Joker and you won the game. Leastways, you won this hand. But I wouldn't linger if I were you. You can only play the Joker once and get away with it. Anyway, be lucky, my friend.
Bye.
Once Ariadne's gone, Motley leaves for the last time this series. The team then guide Giles to the exit.
Let me take you back to Friday the 21st of December 1990. I was 7.5. I was wanting things in this final episode to keep me stimulated that I'd perhaps been hoping to see in the series, or wondering what they'd be like. And I had been wondering about that Joker card, which we'd first seen back in Simon's Quest, way back in episode 8. I wanted to see it played. I wanted to see how it worked. I wanted to see how Motley was going to be involved in the scene that ensued, which obviously he was going to be. So I was very pleased when this turned out to be what it was going to be for, the Ariadne scene. I also kind of appreciated the bit of variety with using the Joker card to get past Ariadne instead of a spell. As I mentioned on episode 1 of this series, there was enough in the gameplay, despite all the repetition, to keep me on my toes, to keep me interested. And doing something a bit different to get past Ariadne was one of those things. As I've also mentioned before, I did find Motley very stimulating to watch. Not laugh out loud funny, but I do find Paul Valentine's performance very stimulating, very appealing, and I enjoyed all that ironic jumps into action, flexes his mighty muscles, core, what a body, I says to myself, and prepares for deadly combat. I didn't laugh out loud at it, I found it stimulating, same with Motley insulting Ariadne, and it left me with a feeling of satisfaction before the end of the series. Ah, that's what that was for. It was to call Motley. I do enjoy watching Motley. It was a different way to get past Ariadne. That's kept me on my toes and interested during this final episode. So for me, that's a thumbs up. I hope the listeners of Illusion have appreciated that balance of views about the scene. And hopefully it'll get them thinking about their own thoughts on it, if they have any. Or perhaps they have no particular thoughts on it, like Martin H. It's all in there as an option.
We'll make time, run forwards.
Right, Giles, you're on a riverbank, and in front of you there's a boat with a man sitting in it.
Hurry, team, hurry, for this phase of the dungeon is drawing to a close.
Hello?
Deep is the Dunswater and cold. The fare for the crossing is silver or gold.
Give me the gold bar, Giles. I have a gold bar here.
Brett gets Giles to make the boatman promise that he'll take the Dungeoneer across the Dunswater if he gives him the gold. The boatman merely grunts. Without any other option, the team guide Giles into the boat.
Again, the team just don't seem to be thinking here, do they? Rather than just standing there trying to haggle a price that's already been set in stone for them.
What are they going to do if he says no?
Yeah, well, exactly.
Are they going to swim?
Yeah.
You're in the boat, Giles, and you're rowing across.
Seems an expensive fare, Master. I hope for their sake it's worth it.
Yes, but without the fare, I doubt he'd survive the crossing.
Am I the only one concerned here that the boatsman's grunting noises are more interesting and more full of colourful wits than Motley's mocking of Ariadne? I see.
Giles, you're just coming up alongside the riverbank in like an old castle or something. You're alongside now.
Yeah, I can see the bank.
Right, if you thank the boatman, climb out.
Thanks.
Hold up the eye shield.
Right, go through the door, then.
Where's the door?
There.
In front of you. Right, you're going down these steps.
Now listen, team. That which we call level 3 of the Greater Dungeon must lie somewhere below this fortress, and there must be some way down to it, if only you can find it.
It's the usual superfluous speech. I have to say the Tower of Time has been criminally underexplored in this season. There was potential for at least a couple of extra puzzle rooms instead of using this passive path just to skip over to the third level.
We won't be seeing it again anyway, will we?
No, I've never missed it, I have to say.
The name is better than the location itself, I think.
Definitely, yeah. The Tower of Time has so many implications. You want to know why it's called that, and you want to know, is this some kind of place where you can actually move through time into different eras and things like that? All sorts of possibilities. No idea. You just zip right the way through it. As soon as you're getting through the front door, you're immediately going down into level 3.
Like I say, I always believed that the dungeon exists at all times and the Tower of Time represents some kind of hub.
That would be interesting. But what of it if all you're doing is just going right through it and wind up in level 3?
Here's a point of possibly absolutely no interest. As I implied on episode 1 of this series, I didn't have episode 2 of this series on video until I got it off Paul McIntosh in 1996. So I never heard this called the Tower of Time on a regular basis for a long time when I was watching most of Series 4 on video. So I always find it quite weird to think of it as the Tower of Time. I always think of it as just level 3 in Series 4, which I do really like and find really atmospheric. But it is certainly a very tantalizing, interesting name.
Level 3 is below the Tower of Time rather than the tower itself. The level 2 bit is literally you go through the door and then you're on the staircase.
Challenge also made a little cut for adverts on their original showing of this as Giles comes to the bottom of the staircase, as the eye shield sequence comes to an end. It cuts out the rather awkward bit with Brett saying, "Oh, go to the right, go to the right. Oh, I don't suppose it matters." And of course, well, you can't make him go to the right, can you? It's just what the eye shield is going to do. But there is a story about Tim Child shutting Brett up by telling him, oh, you might be able to control the eye shield a certain amount. There might be secret paths, secret exits that you can go through if you spot them. What a load of crap.
Yes.
That was just to shut him up, make him believe it was real. And he does.
He's trying to maintain the illusion that Brett is sort of inadvertently breaking the fourth wall to highlight what isn't really there.
That's right.
Brett is actually a semi-regular on the Nightmare forums, and I do believe he is aware of this podcast.
Brett, if you are listening, please get in touch. We would actually really like to hear from you.
You're in a circular room, Giles. There's a table in front of you with something on it.
Quickly, there's a skull coming. Giles, run forward to the table. Is there some food? Put it in your knapsack.
Yeah, there's loaves of bread.
Right. And where's the exit?
It's there. Go from it's there.
Okay, Giles, you should move around the table.
But there's a key.
Oh, pick the key up then. Oh, hang on a minute.
No, don't. I've got the key.
You're not, you haven't put it in the knapsack.
I have. I have. I've got the key with me.
All right. Should we...
Go ahead. Go through.
Hang on a minute, Giles.
There's a door there where the light is.
The calling!
Giles!
Merlin! Merlin! Merlin!
Gone the shades of all!
Merlin.
Decent, yes.
There. Thank you, Giles.
It's hectic, this bit of the scene in the circular room.
Giles picks up the key, puts it in his knapsack, remembers that he can't eat a key, and takes it out. I did try and look up if there was some kind of mythical creature that does eat keys or something like that, but all I could think of is the Muncher from Ghostbusters Afterlife. In Korean mythology and folklore, there is a fabled beast known as the Pulgasari that devours metal. The monster is a hybrid of several animals, including a bull, tiger, rhino, elephant, bear, and rhinoceros, each of which represents a different body part.
Thank you for finding the key, Giles. You may leave it on the table, and I'll conjure it back to me later on. Now, in return, I will gift you a spell. It is the spell Tiny. It is a rather small spell.
Tiny.
But I think you will find it has its uses. Now, you approach a power which in this place can be even greater than mine. So, I depart. Well pleased!
That's sort of farewell to Merlin, as we never see him in game again. Although, spoiler, he does appear right at the end of the episode for the close of season. I think this would have been a better note for him to bow out on, because at least you got the vision of him looking really huge at the back of the chamber. So he goes out on a really towering high note. So. It's therefore a bit ironic that the spell he gives out is called Tiny.
Now, during that circular room scene, the fact that the team weren't listening to Merlin at all in the eye shield room really comes back and makes itself apparent. They have no idea what the significance of that key is. They have no idea they were supposed to be calling upon the prisoner. No one's mentioned anything about calling three times. Giles has obviously had in his ear. Call Merlin three times. The advisors, I don't think, even realise that that is what's made Merlin appear. Oh, it's Merlin. Decent. Yes. Merlin appearing in level three, as he should. But this was another thing I'd been wanting to see, longing to see in the series. Merlin appearing in the quest in all his glory. A power exuding big image in level three with his flowing green robes on instead of his... stupid Cedric the Sky.
Going back to how he would often appear in image form in level three throughout the first couple of seasons.
Exactly. I really like this scene. I used to sometimes rewind it and watch it again. The screen presence of John Woodnut, the significance of the character Merlin, really after it having not been like that before in the quest in series 4, it was something very special. And I do enjoy it very much. It's another of those quite poignant moments where I get a pang watching Nightmare because, of course, as you were saying, it's Merlin's swan song, really.
As I say, I think that would have been a better final appearance for him than what he actually ended up with at the end of the episode. At the same time, I wouldn't exactly say it's a standout moment. It is nice to see him getting that role from earlier seasons back again for one last time, though, so it's a plus.
There we go. We found more common ground on that one than the Ariadne scene, but not as much as the whole Dick and Winning scene. I don't think that will ever be topped.
Where am I? You're a large rogue, Giles, and in front of you there's two skulls. And dead in front of you there's a table, and to the right of you there's a chest or something.
Let's turn to your right then.
Dangerous hauntings, team. Timing is essential here.
Giles, turn to your right and there's a chest in front of you. Can you go, no, left a bit. If you brought forward to the chest and see what's in it. Can you see the chest? Stop, turn to your left.
Shadow.
I don't think you'll find much help from the chest.
Nothing.
Pickle, you notice, tries to hurry the team up by saying they won't find anything in the chest. Why should they believe him? It's so obvious they're just trying to hurry things up that it almost breaks the fourth wall again.
The skulls are crossing paths in front of the corridor entrance, making for a seemingly difficult timing puzzle. The team line Giles up with the centre and instruct him to run forward straight into the corridor without skipping a beat.
Now go, run! Keep going! Well done, good boy.
Giles, duck!
Duck, Giles! The massive blade has gone overhead.
Listen very carefully. Move to your right, Giles!
Quickly!
Move to your right! To the right wall! Now, Andrew and Brett, Robin, guide him well!
Oh no! It's the corridor!
The team keep Giles to the lower right for the next few blades, then only narrowly move him out of the way of a blade coming towards him. They then instruct Giles to throw himself against whichever wall they say and manage the rest of the corridor like this. So this isn't bad. It's not bad at all.
Giles is lucky, though. Firstly, the first few blades, as you mentioned, are all heading down the left wall, so he's able to just stay safely stuck to the right wall. Then when one appears on the right-hand side, I'm absolutely certain it connects with his shoulder.
Yeah, I think you're right.
As he makes the mistake of ducking down before moving away. So he did get away with one there. There's also something inadvertently comical about the advisor saying there are blades moving down the corridor after Charles already dodged five of them.
I think they realise that they haven't actually told him what's going on.
I know. But anyway, I count 13 blades overall, which I think is a record for the corridor of blades. Yeah. It's a lot of them.
They run the entire blade sequence twice here for the only time, perhaps as a punishment for that graze you were talking about, perhaps just to fill in some time before the end of the series. But it does show up the problem with ducking. Giles gets into the routine of ducking to avoid the blades on the right of the screen, and of course once there's one on tummy level, we're in trouble.
Well, precisely.
I would caution against ducking thanks to this scene.
Stay upright, but just get your back to the wall. And then when the blade starts coming down that wall, just move all the way across and just get you back to the other wall.
Which is pretty much what they do in the end.
Stiletta is right, isn't she? Fling your whole body from wall to wall. That's the way to do it.
Oh, there's a door coming up.
There's a door there, Giles.
Right, so
walk forward.
Walk forward, see the door.
He ran through. Giles, you're on a path. And either side, there looks like a huge drop.
Giles, there's some food in front of you. Can you see it?
Yeah.
Move carefully forwards.
Is my foot all right?
Yeah. Pick up the food.
Extreme caution, team. Something most unpleasant is about to make its presence felt.
Welcome, foolish one. Thrice-timed welcome. As for you who watch, look upon Modred now. Look upon Modred and quail. There will be no interference, Giles. You have come quite far enough. Unless you wish to pledge allegiance to me, your progress is at an end. Do you so pledge?
Giles, say no.
No.
So, defy me.
Say yes.
You have firm ground for taking this stance, I suppose. Somehow, I think not.
Giles has made it to the bridge spanning the cave with the waterfall. There's a food object on the ground and Giles stoops to pick it up. We're assuming it's a food object. And we're never really told, but he seems to put it in his knapsack, so...
Another key, perhaps.
John Woodnut hasn't quite bowed out yet, as the evil alter ego makes one final play. And this is his final appearance. He's apparently back in charge in level 3 notice. If you remember, he'd been overthrown, or appeared to have been overthrown earlier in the season. It's a shame his dialogue here, though, is almost totally unchanged from the corresponding scene against Helen in Quest 1. Only at the end of the scene does it really deviate at all. Another thing that detracts a bit from it is that Giles sounds very, very flippant when he refuses to pledge to Mogdred, which kind of spoils the tone. It's a bit sad because it's clear that Woodnut is determined to play the scene to its fullest and as dramatic as possible, because he knows this is probably his last moment as Mogdred.
It's a fairly fitting final appearance for Mogdred in his 11th and final episode ever.
It isn't as many as you'd think, is it?
Because he was absent for the entirety of season 1 despite being in the credits.
Yeah.
It's a fairly fitting ending for him. In only his second episode of Series 4. Compare Mogdred's 11 episodes out of 56 in the 4 series he's ostensibly a part of to Lord Fear's 53, and you really see the difference in how they're used. Difference in the gameplay.
They're very different characters as well. Lord Fear is much, much... shall we say he's got rather more colour to him than Mogdred, to put it politely.
They very much fit very well as a concept into their half of Nightmare. Now the show develops and why Lord Fear is brought in and what he is used for. Comparing Series of Nightmare is such a ticklish business, and different ones do have different advantages, and you perhaps get different things out of them. Mm. I always feel that I kind of grew in age to match Nightmare kind of coming down and what it was being aimed at. And I kind of met it in the middle in about Series 6 when I was 9. And I thought I really had a handle on it and engaged with it there. Perhaps the best I ever did, the most completely I ever did. And then coming back in later years to rewatch the first 3 series, I very much appreciate them as well, but some of the magic of my hazy early memories when I didn't really understand what was going on has disappeared over the years. It's a very hard thing to do, I find, comparing different series and experiences with different series, because the show does change and develop so much. And so do we, as we grow up.
Mogdred cackles as he vanishes from view and the bridge begins to crumble. Giles moves quickly across the bridge, stumbling a little as he does, but he makes it across onto more solid ground. Or is it?
Giles is still on the bridge. He's falling away quickly.
Run!
Run! Forward.
Quick!
Run! Giles, take large side steps to your right.
How many?
Quickly. Quickly. And another. Stop, tangent. Walk, run forward. Stop, tangent, right.
We're into the block and tackle, and it starts up so swiftly. Traeger doesn't even get the chance to say his usual spiel before everything starts to disintegrate.
Giles is halfway across the room before it even stops moving. But I do like the way that it connects to the falling bridge.
It actually feels like the block and tackle has been triggered by the same effect that caused the bridge to start crumbling. Mm.
The team handle this room with the grace and decorum of a 2-year-old on Red Bull.
Yes. There's no doubt about that. No matter how many times I watch this scene, I still can't for the life of me figure out how Joel survived it. It's like watching a Harold Lloyd movie.
I just count of how many times they almost kill him.
That's definitely Hugo laughing at the end, not Traeger, by the way.
Yeah.
It's not actually good dungeoneering, but they got him through. Although, there is a little detail that's often not known about this. According to Brett, writing on the Nightmare Forum a few years later, they actually failed the puzzle originally, and for some reason, they were allowed to redo it, and they got it right second time, sort of. This is the thing I was going to mention, as I mentioned earlier. I don't understand why they did a retake here. Surely the quest ending at this room would have been ideal, because it means it's coinciding with the end of the season, which is about a minute away anyway. They can just expand a couple of the earlier scenes and then put this one in.
Maybe expanding the other scenes just meant that it wasn't good television.
Well, it isn't anyway.
You don't necessarily want...
Let me continue, because you've got to see this in the perspective of what followed. When you do the retake, you then have to do another scene afterwards, but you can't even get it started because time runs out anyway.
Yeah, but...
It's crap. There's no getting away from this. It's crap. Just get rid of that last scene and use the first version of this one, and then you've got lucky timing here that this quest is actually, in reality, has ended at exactly the right time for the season to end.
You don't want to end your season on a death. That's too much of a downer.
Well, did
That's
it in
not
season...
good TV.
They did it in season one. Why not? You know, everyone's complaining. The same people who say that are the same ones who are also complaining that the season finishing mid-quest is an anticlimax.
Yeah, that's true.
So, you know, what do you want them to do? What they end up coming up with later seasons was the quest gets abandoned, but there's some kind of dramatic secondary quest they've got to carry out to save Nightmare Castle or something. So at least you get something kind of excitement to end on, which is probably the best solution. They hadn't really thought of that at this point. So what do? They either stop and slap bang in the middle of the quest, which feels very unfair on the team. Mm. Or if you're lucky, you get just the right amount of time for the death scene to be put in. At least then they haven't been cheated. I really do not understand why they abandoned the original version of that and then had to start up another scene 1 minute later, which they literally don't even get it started. They don't even take the first step on the transporter pads.
I absolutely love this scene. As you say, it is hilarious. Brett and his hat has a guidance that never should have worked, but apparently did. When Paul McIntosh wrote Remember This, The Block and Tackle, in the very first issue of the iShield fanzine back in December 1995, he said, The Block and Tackle was so hard and had killed so many teams that by the end of the series it had moved to level 3 instead of being on level 2. And I thought, well, surely they stuck it in at the end there to try and kill off Giles at the end of the series. It's not really supposed to be a part of level 3. It's just meant to be there to pick him off. He comes in at the same very awkward angle, sending him over the collapsing side that Jeremy does. I always thought it was a very deliberate attempt to kill them off to coincide with the end of the series that Brett managed to foil with his very haphazard but ultimately successful piece of guiding. If it is a second film, I find that very surprising. Particularly with how panicked Brett is by what's going on. I think they must have done, if that's true, and I suppose it must be true if Brett's come along and said it. It must be a spice, really.
I can't think of a reason why he'd make it up. It just doesn't make sense to me doing that. They've now left the team feeling cheated. They've suddenly got a room further on, and then they're suddenly deprived of their chance to finish the quest. All they've done is leave everybody more dissatisfied. You can definitely feel that they're making up as they go along.
I'm just reading the guest book on Nightmare.com, and Giles signed it, saying that he actually broke the helmet at one point. Well, imagine breaking your helmet.
Ooh. That's painful.
Robin's main memory was that everything at the hotel was paid for.
Turn to your right. Turn to your left a bit. And run forward, quickly. Stop, turn to your left. Run right a bit. And run. Stop, turn to your right. Right, run forwards.
Run.
Quickly.
Run. Where am I?
You're in an archway at the top of a large room. Don't move. Below you, there's
yes,
a step.
Stay right where you are, Giles. You see, we can see you, but we can't see what you're standing on. Look down beneath the helmet and tell us what you see.
It's like a propeller symbol to my right, which curls at each end. And on the other side, there's a round symbol with two twirly things in the middle.
Oh, yes, of course, it's a transporter pad.
Oh, wow.
Step right for one journey, step left for another.
Don't forget, though, Giles, return always to the middle.
Right.
Otherwise, the journey may be longer than you'd intended.
But anyway, the fact is they did go with the second take, which somehow Brett managed to get just about right. And so they wind up in the transporter pad room. I think our audience by now was probably... If they didn't know already, you've got the idea that this is going to be the last chamber. Before the team could do anything else, though, the swirl effect fills the screen.
Circle. Step to your right.
Right, listen.
It's happening, Master. It's happening. 180-degree phase shift approaching. It's the end of the dungeon.
Don't panic now. The dungeon never ends, you silly sprite.
It's just the end of this particular era.
I'm sorry, team, but the path is closing. There's no time for your challenge to win through in this phase.
I got all excited over this bit, and then I was let down. I just found the series 3 ending so exciting with the bells and the feel of danger, and it's completely lacking from this.
The magical effect of everything fading out of existence. You don't get it in this one at all, do you? They just cut straight back to the antechamber and that's about it.
I'll tell you the two things I like from this bit. Pickle's phrase, 180 degree phase shift occurring. That made me think, oh, that's an interesting way to express, like, the end of the series. They've described Time Out as a phase shift, but this is a 180-degree phase shift. Wow, significant. Doesn't really mean anything, but it worked on me at the time. I love the way Traegard says, after Pickle says it's the end of the dungeon, the dungeon never ends, you silly sprite. Now, I used to, 4 years later, look back at that and think, oh, it does, I wish it hadn't. But of course, Traegard's right, in a way, isn't he? The dungeon never ends. The fact that we're sitting here recording this in 2024 is testament to the fact that the dungeon hasn't ended for us. It's in all of us. So even when they stop making the show after another 4 series, this is the exact halfway point in terms of episodes as well as series. Even after that, the dungeon doesn't end. It carries on in a different way in the hearts and minds of those of us who have taken it in there and kept it there forever.
Every time somebody writes a fanfic, every time we make an audio play, the dungeon stays alive through that. Every time the Nightmare Live fellas are on stage in the theatres, they're keeping the dungeon alive. It's still there. Traegard's, what he said has become more literally true than he probably meant it to be at the time, because I don't think here we are, literally 30 years after it ended, and there is still a following for it. People on the internet are still making stuff like this about it.
We must rescue Giles. Spellcasting. U-N-I-T-E.
It's not over, Master. It's not over. Something awesome is approaching. I can sense it.
Spellbound incantations! Tell that elf-wit to stop cowering, Dungeon Master. There's nothing to fear. Only one thing approaches. And anyone but a half-witted elf-wit would know what it is. Do you want a hint? Very well. That approaches. In fact, it is almost upon us. You do want to be home for Christmas, don't you, boys? Yes, I thought so. Do the honors, will you, Dungeon Master?
But of course, Merlin. Spellcasting. D-I-S-M-I-S-S. Farewell, Giles, Robin, Andrew, and Brett. Have a safe journey home. And a very Merry Christmas to you.
Let's talk about the team being sent home for Christmas, because this is a bullshit ending.
It is. It's awful. Sorry, Jake, in advance. It is awful. It causes huge anger to a lot of people.
It does. Everyone hates it, except me.
If any scene in Nightmare really goes out of its way to tell the audience that they're watching a kid's show, it's this one. A Christmas farewell scene. It's infantile.
I'm looking at the forum now, and Giles hated it as well. The team hated it. Giles says it was really childish, made us feel really uncomfortable, and it was filmed in mid-August.
Yes, those are exactly the points I was about to say. The team themselves have often complained about it in subsequent years. It won't have helped that this big fuss about Christmas approaching was made while filming in August. And they look a little narked at getting some way into level 3 and then getting the dismiss spell as their only reward at the end of it. You know, at least you could have used a different spell, just the home spell, maybe. Maybe, or something. Don't dismiss them.
They don't even get them walking away.
Well, they're just sent away and that's it.
Giles hints that there's a reason for that in his dishing the dirt thread on the forum. So we looked into the forum posts a bit more after this, and allegedly, and I want to stress, allegedly, The reason that they didn't get the shot of the team walking away is because as they did so, Brett turned round and gave the camera the finger. I found the bit about the team's second chance, and it wasn't on the block and tackle. It was on the place of choice.
Well, hey, engineer, with the helmet on your head, but you go for the cup or the crown instead of the sword or the shield, because there's nothing in between. Oh, hey, venture, don't be alarmed, but one false move can cause you harm. If you slip on the disc, you'll end up in the ravine. At the place of choice. At the place of choice. The place of choice. At the place of choice.
Well, that puts a totally different light on it.
Giles says, I fell off the turntable in the first room. It was nerves, really. I stepped on, lost my footing and went off. We went back into the green room area. As you can imagine, the rest of the team weren't too happy with me. Then the director came in and told us everyone got a second chance. It wouldn't be good viewing if everyone died on the first level. Maybe that's where the rumour comes from.
Well, no, because Brett himself said it. I think go to the season 4 end of quest page. He actually says they messed up the block and tackle, and so the chaotic one that we see is actually the second take.
We recorded more than one ending. The floor manager explained this was due to selling Nightmare to other countries, including the USA and Spain, where it would not necessarily be Christmas when the series ended. It doesn't say anything about the block and tackle.
Let me see if I can find it, because I definitely saw it yesterday. It almost never gets shown at Christmas in the UK these days. When it appears on Challenge, they just go round and round and round, whatever episode. Episodes next is next.
Oh, hang on. Series 4 teammate Brett. I don't remember Giles falling off the spin dizzy, although it took about 5 minutes, including Traeguard's introduction, and was drastically cut due to the timing of episode 14. I think Giles's recollection of being pulled up by the producer related to throwing a spanner in the works when he lobbed the spanner across the studio at the last minute as we were looking for the works into which to throw the spanner. That's when the producer said they always allow one level one boo-boo. But on neither occasion were the rest of the team annoyed with Giles, or indeed at any other time. It seems sometimes you were wrong for overthinking it on the game, whilst also sometimes wrong if you don't think enough, or very similar way to the author. That's always been the trouble with all these games, role-playing text-based adventure games, as I see it.
Okay, if you go to the Quest 8 page, go to the picture where the block and tackle is the free table block and tackle. There's a quote from Brett just under that. He says, there was no time to have any kind of pattern and make a plan. It just seemed like the game environment was collapsing around Giles, and we did what we could. We did actually fail the block and tackle first time around. What you saw is the second take.
Oh, okay.
So it is there.
Right, I'll say my bit about this scene. I don't mind it. I've never minded it. When I first watched this, I was super stoked for Christmas coming up. I was really pleased that Merlin appeared in all his glory again to help with the end of the series. I can see why other people don't like it, but I don't mind it at all.
As a kid, I don't think I minded it.
One conspiracy theory that I remember from many, many years ago, I don't believe it, by the way. There was one regular user on the Nightmare Forum who really did not like John Woodnutt. He was putting forward the idea that that Christmas scene was actually Woodnutt's idea, and he was putting it in there to make sure that he got a really grand send-off from the series. I don't believe that. I don't think no. That's true, but no. I'm putting it out there just for people to consider.
I've always thought the theory that we didn't see the team leaving because Brett flipped off Traeguard had some gravitas to it. So I always picture him there behind the screen flipping Traeguard off as Traeguard wishes him a very Merry Christmas.
Brett, is that true? Did you flip Traeguard the birdie?
I don't think he's here, mate. I don't think he can.
No, but I'm really kind of thinking that he is probably amongst our audience.
He might very well be here in spirit, yeah.
If we're reaching Jake's Lollipop friends, we're probably reaching a few more Dungeoneers and advisors than we realise.
Yeah. I think you do have to look at it for viewpoint of the team as well. It's really patronising to them. They weren't a great team, but they were good enough to deserve a proper ending to their quest one way or the other. And doing this instead of having an ending is patronising to them and also to the viewers.
My memories of it at the time are only vague, but Jake, your memories are quite strong, aren't they? of watching it as a kid and the feeling that you had when you were a kid.
Yes, particularly with Series 4, as I did record it and watch it back every week and really get to know it so well and engage with it in such a big way. Series 4, I've always been incredibly familiar with. It's a big part of my emotional makeup. Nightmare as a whole, but really Series 4 in particular for several reasons.
And as for you lot, the season's greetings to you, of course. The path from you to here is closing now, just as the winter is closing in upon us. When will it reopen? Who knows? But the signs will be there, if you know where to look.
Credits play over a video of Gundrada swinging her sword with the Series 4 pool room in the background. And it is good to see Gundrada one last time, I think.
It's also the last time we see Samantha Perkins at all, which is a shame.
Yes, but watch until the end of these credits. We won't tell you what happens, but it is a giggle.
He's obviously trained hard to do that sword play, but nobody's perfect. When Treyguard says, the signs will be there if you know where to look, I thought, yes, I know where to look. The Radio Times.
Yeah.
And then I thought, oh no, the TV Times, actually, as it's ITV. But then, in the spring of 1991, they both started listing all four channels for the first time. So you can look in the Radio Times or the TV Times, whichever you prefer.
I remember my mum was delighted because I meant she didn't have to buy copies of both every week anymore.
The Radio Times had quite a lot to say about Series 5 of Nightmare coming up. It confused me into thinking that Treyguard had gone and Pickle was going to be the only host.
Ah, what a horrible thought.
It was not a very good thought, and I was very relieved before Episode 1 of Series 5 actually aired, and the next issue of the Radio Times came out. There was a picture of Treyguard and Pickle together.
Even as a Pickle apologist, I think that would have been a bit far. Martin, I know that when we entered Series 4, you were quite apprehensive about it. Has looking back on it at all changed your opinion much?
No.
Did it get any better or any worse?
Not really, no. Looking at this episode, I really do hate it. It's too much same old once again. The best moment is only fun because it was done wrong. The Motley versus Ariadne scene is badly paced and written appallingly. And the ending just makes a complete hash of the season's close. And another thing I don't think gets mentioned enough about Season 4 is tonal consistency is very poor. You keep on getting these forced in joke moments where you need a sense of danger and urgency. Level 3 of all places that you kept on getting these silly things happening. So you end up playing for laughs when you're supposed to be scared.
I do enjoy the Lost Joker scene. I enjoy it because it is a monumental f***ed up and that is quite well covered up.
This team, reflecting on them, they're an oddity, I think is the best word for them. There are times when they're so slack, you almost thought the floor manager had to pour them onto the set. But they also had moments of real genius. In a strange way, as chaotic as it was, there was something strangely genius about the way Brett got Charles through the block and tackle at the second attempt.
The funny thing is, if you look at them as a team, they're actually quite well organised. They've got one person doing the directions, one person doing the spell casting, one person doing the descriptions.
It does have all the right elements there as a team. It's just, they just seem to keep switching off for no particular reason.
Maybe it was the wrong people doing each thing. I don't know.
That could be it, yeah. The season as a whole did have moments that stand in comparison with any elsewhere in Nightmare history, but there's just nowhere near enough of them. A lot of the quests are almost impossible to distinguish from each other, so the series structure is too tight, it's too inflexible, that it gives it a monotony.
Having the same script for each episode just kind of deal it a bit of a blow.
The visuals are frequently abysmal, especially the bizarre fixation on adding a pink tinge to the entirety of the first two levels. The best thing by far was Malice. I think she was a really great character, and it's such a shame they didn't retain her for one more year. The worst was Mistress Goody, for the simple reason there was no need for her to ever be in it. Motley was awful, certainly worse than he was in Season 3. And Melisandre was even worse than Motley, and thankfully she wouldn't be back for another season.
I don't think either of them were that particularly bad, except for Motley meaning to be bad.
Motley, if you're going to forgive him, okay, but what the hell was the point of Melisandre? She just kept on becoming an obstacle to any dungeoneer who helped her. She was almost as useless as Goody.
She did basically turn into Gretel, didn't she?
Yeah.
Jake, you're looking very pensive. Do you want to offer a counterpoint?
I was just looking at the sea, actually, assessing the roughness. I would never want to disagree with or try and mitigate any of the problems people have with Series 4, because I think they are problems with Series 4. Nonetheless, I do love Series 4. And I direct you back to my fairly lengthy thesis in episode 1 of this series for all the reasons why, on a personal and perhaps in places more objective level. But that's what it is. I always love it, and it will always be particularly special to me, despite its problems. Like many people and things that we love, I'm sure.
I do rather like level 3 in season 4, but it's actually underlined one of the mistakes I think they did make that year, which was introducing outdoor locations, the photographic ones in particular. You've removed the dark, grimy, otherworldly indoor scenes from the dungeon hand-drawn rooms, which allow you to create much more unnatural details and make it more sorcerous. When you go into level 3 and suddenly everything's indoors again and everything's dark and gloomy, you got the wonders of the water cavern amongst other things, and you think, that's it, that's the direction it should have gone in.
There are some great bits, but the whole isn't greater than the sum of its parts.
It is not.
Let's not end it on a down note, because I'm sure Jake wants to get home in time for Christmas. You do want to get home in time for Christmas, don't you, Jake? Jake is now flipping us off. So. But that's it for this episode, and that's also it for this series. We'll be taking a break, during which Patreon supporters will be able to listen to Series 2 of the Nightmare Audio series, whilst the free feed will have the delights of Jake's own audio series, Nightmare the Lost Series. We'll be back soon after with Series 5, Episode 0, where we talk about the stuff that's gone on during the off-season, and Series 5 proper, which features another round of big changes to the Nightmare format. We'd like to thank a few people before we sign the series off. Firstly, a big thank you to all our guests in the series for sharing your thoughts and experiences. Thanks also to Jason Carl for his help in putting us in contact with a lot of our past and future guests. A big thank you to Jake and Rosie Collins for voicing the Door Monsters for us this series. And of course, thank you, Jake, for being a regular guest on this series.
I've enjoyed it.
Glad you've enjoyed it.
Mostly.
Huge thanks to our friend Amy Davies for her help with our coverage of the Nightmare screening at Square Eyes TV Festival in Birmingham. A special shout out to the Mockingbird Cinema in Birmingham for hosting the event, and to the Board Game Cafe Chance Encounters for allowing us to record there. As usual, thank you to the folk behind Nightmare.com and Interactive Nightmare for helping to keep the memory of the show alive all this time, and also providing us with some research material. And big thank you to all our listeners and fans for bearing with us through what has been a rather difficult time for me personally, trying to juggle the podcast and work and my academic studies and everything. But most of all, we'd like to thank the wonderful Clifford Norgate. And we just want to say rest in peace, Hordris. We'll see you on the other side.
Your mention of the Chance Encounters thing. There's also, I recently managed to play the Nightmare board game at a little board game cafe that's recently opened up across the road from Heaton Park tram station in Manchester. If you're ever in Manchester and you're a Nightmare fan, try and drop in on it. Go to Heaton Park tram station. It's literally right across the road from the exit to the station, and they're all Nightmare fans in there, so give them a try.
If you'd enjoyed the podcast, please give us a rating and review on your platform of choice. It really helps us to grow our audience by reaching others who might be interested.
And if you didn't enjoy our podcast, go away and leave us alone. We love it. You can follow us on Twitter. We're at Nightmare Pod, and our Mastodon, that's Mastodon, is topspicy.social oblique at Nightmare Pod.
Oblique?
Yeah.
Is that what it's called? I always call it forward slash.
Well, forward slash if you prefer, but yeah, the correct name for it is oblique. Okay.
It's an oblique. It's the correct name for it. Oh, I'm not one of your forward slash commoners.
If you want to support the podcast, it's Nightmare Pod on Patreon.
Speaking of Patreon, here's a shout out to Keepers of the Book of Quest, David M. Rabbit, Paul McIntosh, Peter Polsford, and Scott Evans.
Advisors, Benjamin Bloom, David Thompson, Kim Harder, which is a really silly surname. Peter Sidorn, Paul Craddy, Lord Entropy, where the O is a zero, and Stephen Whelan.
And let's not forget Dungeoneers Peter Courage and Adam Battersby.
Support us on Patreon at Dungeoneer level or above to get your name mentioned on the podcast. Higher level perks also receive merchandise, have access to exclusive episodes, and if you pledge as a keeper of the Book of Quests, we'll even offer you the chance to be a guest on the podcast.
Our website is nightmarepods.co.uk.
If you're looking for temporal discussion merchandise, and let's face it, you're probably not, including t-shirts, stickers, and other products, it's nightmarepod.redbubble.com.
Before we do anything else, Jake, did you want to tell the people what to search for on YouTube to get your podcast?
You can search for the Olden Days podcast on YouTube to find a very extensive range of discussions between Rosie and myself that you may or may not find interesting in places.
You can email us at podcast@nightmarepod.co.uk.
And just keep telling yourself,
it's only a podcast, isn't it?